Aren't you glad this morning it's His faithfulness? Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Number 109, let's sing that out this morning unto the Lord. He's worthy of our worship this morning.
Great is Thy faithfulness.
Second and third this morning, we'll hold that faithfulness at the end of the chorus, all right? On the second.
Summer and winter and spring.
Let's turn to number 246 this morning. Number 246, Calvary covers it all. Number 246.
Far dearer than all, than the world can impart, was the message that came to my heart. How that Jesus alone, for my Savior,
my past is sin. that Naomi? What a blessing that is to hear.
If you've never heard Naomi singing, that's a blessing. That just thrilled my heart to hear it. I knew that was her behind me this morning. She's a blessing. Amen. All right, let's turn our attention this morning to birthdays and anniversaries. We have a number of those. We'll start with the birthdays on the 17th. I'm trying to think. That's 2 days from now. We have Kaylee. Did I say that right? Is she here this morning? Kaylee James. I think I always mess up her name. And Connie Dodge. And here's another one I'm going to have a tough time with. I should have gone over these this morning before I came to church. Malia Hardy. Did I get that right? Where is he? He's back. He's way back there somewhere. Well, hopefully I got that right. On the 18th, we have Esther Waltice. We have on the 20th, Sienna Stamper. Boy, I'm having a tough time today. And on the 21st, Cammie Souter. On the 22nd, Glenn Beller. And you people that have to come up with these interesting spellings for names. We also have Alea Coop. Help me this morning, please. Folks, I'm having a tough time. Anyhow, you all know who they are, I hope. So let's sing happy birthday to these folks this morning.
Happy birthday to you. To Jesus be true. God bless you and keep you.
Next week I'm going to be studying the newsletter before I come. I'll get them right. All right, we have five anniversaries to go through this morning as well. On the 18th, AJ and Noel Waltice. How many years, AJ?
Two
years. All right. And then we have on the 19th, Sean and Anna Hardy. Are they here this morning? Sean's probably on the road. Is Anna here? I don't know. How many years? Does anybody know how many years they've been married? The whole family is discussing it back there. Well, happy anniversary to them this morning. So let's give them a hand as well. It's hard enough keeping track of your own anniversary without your children, isn't it? All right. On the 20th, we have Gary and Kathy Coop. Where are they at this morning? Is he not here as well this morning?
Celebrating the 50.
The how many? 50. All right. Well, they deserve to be out celebrating that. Amen. That's a blessing. 50. All right. Randy and Connie Stafford on the 21st. Is Randy back here? Are they out celebrating too? Oh, there he is. 38. One more on the 22nd, Ty and Kaylee James. Are they here this morning? Everybody's out celebrating. Oh, is he back there?
Yeah.
How many years? There he is. 12. All right. All right, let's sing happy anniversary. Busy month of June. Let's sing happy anniversary to all these folks.
Happy anniversary to you, to Jesus be true. God bless you.
And just remember that on the 29th we have the Camp Joy cleanup, and then fast approaching is Camp Joy in July from the 8th through the 27th. So be in prayer for that. That's a great opportunity to reach young people all over this region, and be in prayer for Brother Van as he continues to be on the road for that. All right, I think that's everything this morning, unless anybody else has anything. Let's sing again, all right? Let's sing number 594. Number 594, A Glorious Church Without Spot or Wrinkle, Washed in the Blood of the Lamb. Number 594.
Do you hear them coming, Father, thronging up the steeps of light, clad in glorious shining garments, the blood looks pure and
Washed in the blood of the Lamb.
funny. How many know this song? I'm getting a little bit of confused looks out there this morning. Not too many. Not too many know this song? Okay, I thought we'd sung it recently. I must have been thinking of another one. This is a good song about the church being the bride of Christ. Let's sing the third stanza this morning. We'll slow it down just a little bit so everybody can kind of get it.
Never fear the clouds of sorrow. Never fear the storms of sin. We will triumph on the morrow. Even now our joys begin. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb.
All right, greet each other this morning. Be sure to, there's a visiting family here from Illinois, came 6 hours to be with us today, so be sure to greet them. They're back near the Lakeys, and greet other visitors this morning that may be here. Have a word of prayer with each other as well. way back to your seats this morning. We'll have our Bible reading. Make your way back to your seats. We'll have our Bible reading this morning from Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3 this morning. We'll do our responsive reading. We'll give the choir a little bit of opportunity to come in here. Ephesians chapter 3 this morning.
All right, Ephesians 3 this morning. Would you stand, please, when you find your place there, and we'll read responsively through Ephesians chapter 3. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words.
Whereby, when he read, he made understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ,
which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, but it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit.
That the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel.
Wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power.
Unto me, who am blessed and the least of all saints, it is a grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ,
and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Christ, by Jesus Christ.
To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God,
according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord.
In whom you have boldness and access to confidence by the faith of him.
Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory.
For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ,
of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named,
that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man,
that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love,
may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height,
and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God.
And unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us.
Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen.
Thank you. carry you through. I said, are you glad you got a Savior that will carry you through? I tell you what, if you're here this morning, say amen. If you ain't all here, say, somebody help me. Brother Lonnie, come up here and tell us why you're glad God lets you be a father. Come on up here while the Carpenter family's coming. Boy, and I see my favorite instrument over here, a banjo. Come on, Lonnie. You mess around with me, I'll make you play a song or a piano. This guy can play the piano and everything. I love this guy. He is a blessing to me. And you know what I like about him? He knows that he needs grace. And I've watched him over the years, how God's given him grace through trial after trial. And Brother Lonnie, I just want you to give a testimony. Would you just...
Wow, thanks for the warning.
Thanks for the warning.
Yeah, appreciate
You're
that.
Just as welcome as flowers in spring, buddy.
I don't even know what to say. I mean, it's unbelievable blessing to be a father. You know, I don't deserve anything good of God and of myself. I don't know. It's just a blessing that God has allowed me to be a father. Have a wonderful wife, and I really appreciate that. And I don't know, Rich, what else I can even say.
You know what? It's not so much what you say in life, it's what you do. And he and his wife have had a lot of challenges in life, but I've watched God give them grace for that. Lonnie, I want to thank you for being a godly father in this church, for the influence you've been. There's a lot of men I could have called up here, you know, same way, but it seemed like the Lord just put you on my heart. And so you can blame God. Don't blame me, man. No, I just want you to know I appreciate you. I appreciate all the men of this church and the fathers of this church. I'd like for all the daddies to stand. If you're here today and you're a father, God's given you that privilege. Would you stand? Would you stand? Guys, hey, pan that camera. Pan that camera. Would you pan that camera around if you can? I'm telling you something. This is what... A lot of things makes this church go, but I can tell you one thing, without this right here, it would not be what it is.
Amen.
And if there's anything America needs in this day and time, it's men that love the Lord, love His Word, love their wives, their children, and love the Lord and serving the Lord. And I just want to tell you, men, I appreciate you, and I don't mean maybe about that. God bless you. Give them another hand of appreciation. Lonnie, I love you. Next time I'll give you half a minute.
Okay, appreciate it.
I did not find out that this family sung till about last week sometime. And so I told them to get right with God. They were in a terrible backslidden condition. And while I'm saying this, there's a family over here from nearby. There aren't they over here? What is your folks' last name? Ben, help me.
Good child.
And they lost their home in fire. Is that correct? And we want you to know that we love you in the Lord. And Danny's wife takes care of the checking account here, but the church wants to give you $2,000 a day to help you. Okay? And I'll probably work that through Ben or somebody. That'd be all right, Ben. Can I work that through? But there's also Sister Kelly has things, material goods that you can give them. But you lost their home in the fire. And we want you, I don't know you personally, but I know one thing. If I lost my home in fire, be a rough deal. You lost what?
My brother and their father as well.
Yes.
You lost your brother and their father. I am so sorry. I have no idea what you've been going through, kids. But I want you to know God loves you. And He's a father to the fatherless. I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to give those kids by themselves $2,000. We're going to give the family $2,000. Because you're going to need some help. Okay? And I want you to know something else. You ever get in a tight place, you call this church. We'll help you.
Thank you.
You know, I'm not trying. I did not know that. I'm sorry. Anyway, I'm glad y'all got right with God. And we're glad. They're a blessing. This bunch is a blessing. Anyway, I'll shut up. Y'all come on. And don't sit back. We get right there. Alrighty. I know. Right there. I know how people do. They'll just sit back here, you know. And this. Anyway, I'll leave you alone.
go with God
and leave the world behind.
Trouble for you to bring that clear over here and undo them cases for one song. We paid $5 a piece to hear this, and we want another song. Really, seriously, would you come up and sing another song? And don't y'all think that'll save me a thing? Well, get the money's worth, right?
I don't know how to play banjo.
And he
He's able every step to lead. We walk hand in hand through this pilgrim land. Here we linger for a day, but soon we'll leave this land of night for that land so bright. There, my friend and I will stay. We walk hand in hand through this pilgrim land. Here we linger for a day, but soon we'll leave this land of night for that land so bright. There, my friend and I will stay.
Boy, that's a blessing, isn't it? Man, that's good. I don't know about you, but that fed my soul, my heart, my spirit. This week, how many members, Brother Andrew Phipps? You remember him? I started reading his book this week. He gave me a copy of it. And I seem like I remembered him saying something about a message, but in the book he tells the whole chapter about the loss of their six-year-old son. And that just didn't happen overnight. It was a drug-out situation. And, you know, to be around him, you would never know. When you're sitting in this auditorium today, you do not know the sorrows that people are carrying within their hearts that may be very close to you. People that have lost loved ones and went through things that you'll never dream about. And while they were singing, and I was thinking about this, and I don't want to aggravate you, sister, but step up here, just if you will. She lost her husband. Tell us just a little bit. I don't know how that happened and when it happened or anything. Would you care to? What I'm saying that here's some kids that lost their daddy too. I mean, it's all around you. There's sorrow, grief. But if you don't mind, sister, I don't know, and I appreciate you telling us.
It was in 2013. He fell off a ladder, but it wasn't like way high or anything. It was just a regular ladder. He's working on a door framing, and he had a head injury, and he never woke up enough to speak to us again. He was in the hospital for 12 days, and then he died after 12 days. But I have. We've been singing for a long time, and a lot besides scripture that came to mind, it was a big comfort to me. But the songs were a big comfort too, but also my family, and I know I have people praying for me, and that was a big comfort. In years past, you know, I kind of thought, you know, what if we'd meet a widow or something? I think, well, what if that happened to me? I never came up with any good answers of, you know, like what I would do. But the Lord knew, and the Lord knows. And my kids have been a huge blessing to me, my family, and friends. Just knowing that people are praying for you.
Yeah.
And I know we've been praying for the good childs for their family for a while.
Amen.
And I'm glad to see him here today.
Amen.
God has the answer.
I want to say something to you. Church life is one of the best ways to enrich your life that I know of.
Amen.
And these folks started coming, and I kind of got acquainted with Sam, first of all. I don't know, me and him just kind of hit it off. I just like his spirit, like his attitude. Get in and help sing and so forth like that, but you know, I've kind of finally figured out who all was with him. You know, I thought that can't be. He's blonde-headed and he's black-headed. And maybe he's a cousin. I didn't know, you know, but found out they were brothers. But I want you to know something. The church loves y'all. We deeply, deeply appreciate you. And we're here for you. Okay? And my goodness, if I'd known you sing like that, I'd have had you come sing a long time ago. You ought to ask God to forgive you for such a thing. I'm aggravating you to death, don't I? Would you give them a good hand of appreciation, please? Boy, what a blessing. Man alive, I'll tell you what, that helped me. Amen, that helped me. Is anybody besides me hot? Boy, turn that sucker down to about 51. Open them doors and open them wide. Let that fresh air come inside. Amen. Well, we're going to do something today, I guess. We'll try to get at it. Boy, I'm going to have to put her in high gear, ain't I? 11:30. Tonight, bring your lawn chairs with you. We'll have chairs. If you don't have one, don't worry about it. But if you can, bring some. And guys, be available for any help that Joel might need or Connie might need. All you young men, be on the ball there. But you're going to see a demonstration I think will be a blessing to you. It involves bricks and it involves an anvil and a hammer or a big sledgehammer. So be here with your goggles on. Amen. But I'll tell you, last several weeks have been a blessing. I believe God would have me to preach this morning on the wedding, the biblical wedding traditions and why we have them. I'm probably enjoying church most I've ever enjoyed it in my life. I've always had a good time at church most of the time. But what a great group of young people that God has given this church. And my heart burdens for them, and I'm glad for them. I know there'll be joys and sorrows, but I want to preach today and give some things about this thing. And here's one of the reasons why. Marriage is of God. Weddings are of God. That's where they came from. Genesis chapter 2 was the very first marriage, and God joined Adam and Eve together in holy wedlock. And the Bible starts with a wedding, and the Bible ends with a wedding. And in the middle, God brings forth the church, and His Son is projected or prefigured as a groom of the bride, the church. And it pictures that. And you read that and put up Ephesians chapter 5, verses 30 and 31. So we see in Genesis chapter 2, and I'm going to leave some things out because of time this morning, but I think we'll just try to do the best we can. But did I seem like I'm missing something? Was I supposed to mention something, say something about something going on that I didn't? If I did, I hate that. But let me just say what I've noticed over the years. I hadn't been preaching very long, and a couple called me, and they wanted me to do a wedding up here on the end highway. Wanted me to come up here to a house to do a wedding. So I just said, yeah, I didn't know nothing. I didn't know nothing. I got up there, and this gal that's going to get married, she said, now listen, we want to get married in the living room here. And she said, now I don't want nothing in that vows about me obeying him. And I said, well, that don't sound right to me. I think you might ought to get somebody else to marry you. Well, she said, just go ahead and say it then. I shouldn't have done it, but I did. I went ahead because she didn't mean it, but she said it. A lot of people are saying stuff at weddings that they don't mean, but they're saying it. And here's the problem. Marriage is the foundational of civilization as far as humanity goes. Yep. Yeah. It is the foundational thing. You're going to see a chaotic crumbling of civilization if we keep on the path that we're on with about marriage right now. One man, one woman, home, family, that's the basis of civilization and for everything that you know about it is right and good. Now what I've seen and noticed is, and this is one reason I preach this, is the secularization of weddings. The secularization of weddings. By that I mean, now don't get mad at me. But if you do, I don't care. Okay? I won't enjoy it, but it won't change what I'm going to preach. We've seen a move of to disassociating getting married from the Bible and from God. A secularization of wedding ceremonies. And I found out as a preacher, you can get pulled into things you wish you'd never got pulled into. The same thing going on with funerals. secularization of funerals, detaching them from the Word of God and any acknowledgement of God in the midst of it. So that's one of the reasons I want to get this. But I said salvation is a picture of the church, is a picture of marriage, of Christ and the church. Adam is a type of Christ. Eve is a type of the church. And hence, and because of that, Satan ever works to destroy the concept and the institution of marriage. But he doesn't start it when you get married. He starts it before you ever do get married. And I want to apologize and ask forgiveness for the young people of this church for not really having got in hard and dug in and preached the Bible on what wedding ceremonies ought to be like and what you ought to think about before you ever get married and what your wedding is going to reflect and be. And so God has made me see that I did not have not done as I ought to do that. Jesus' first miracle was performed at a wedding. God talks about weddings in Matthew chapter 22, Luke chapter 12, and so forth. I don't know what in the world that thing's hooked on to, but anyway, we'll get out there after a while. I guess you guys got your guns. I ain't going to worry about mine. Amen. But marriage has a lot of laws and statutes to it in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. There are biblical statutes, judgments, and things pertaining to marriage that God is super serious about. So we'll be looking at some things on that. And I'm going to, like I said, leave some things out tonight. We're going to have this demonstration, and I'm probably going to preach on marriage about strengthening your marriage in existence. But this morning I want to preach on about a wedding. And so there's some things that we take off here. We're going to give you about 20 things of why do they do such things in weddings. Now, numbers, understand again that marriage and the wedding, which is a union of male and female, come together in holy matrimony, is of God Almighty. He created it. He designed it. He is God. He has a right to say what it should be, what it should not be. And there's a lot of, when I got married, many of the things that I'm going to preach about this morning were in Karen and I's wedding. I didn't have a clue why we did it. I did not connect it to Scripture. But I thank God that we had forefathers in this country and preachers who inculcated biblical principles into the wedding ceremony, because weddings are being done out. The church is the bride of Christ. And I'm telling you something, that's a big, big deal. And we'll talk a little bit more about that maybe if we can. Let's get started in this morning. If you want to run these things down or write them down, you're welcome to do it. Number one is, why do ushers seat the family and friends of the bride and groom on the opposite side of the auditorium? In other words, right here is this center aisle, and they'll put, I think it's the bride's family. Is it over here? Somebody help me out. And the groom's family over there. Why do they do that? Well, the reason is because their fight breaks out, they're already on the sides that they need to be. I'm just kidding you, okay? At least you don't have to get over on your side. Why do they put them on that side? Listen, it's because it's a covenant setting. This is the truth. Why did the men of God, and over the years, and Christian people, have this seating of the family on each side? It's because a wedding and a marriage is a covenant, not a contract. A contract is an agreement that you can break, and it's not even before God. A covenant is something that you agree to with God, and it's unbreakable. Now, the covenant setting in the Old Testament, in Genesis chapter 15, now, I'm just going to tell you, this is wild. This is wild. I don't know if God will give me liberty to really preach the depths of this for a little bit. But what happens is that God told Abram at the time, said, you take a heifer and so forth and these birds, and you split them in two, cut them in two, and make a pathway down through the middle. And he went to sleep, and God came through that thing. It was a covenant, all right? Now, covenant involves blood. A blood covenant involves blood. Can I just tell you something? I'll just say this and get it done. Ideally, a marriage consummation involves a blood covenant, blood from the wife, from the bride. It's a blood covenant. Are you listening? I want you boys to listen to me. I want you girls to listen to me. Why do we call it holy matrimony? Why do we have that? Because that setting of two sides that have, watch this, sacrificed for them to be able to come together. Let me tell you something. My mom and dad and Karen's mom and dad sacrificed to get us to that point in their life. But God gave his sacrifice to give a marriage, which is a picture of Christ in the church, and Christ shed his blood. But I'm saying this to you here. We do not take the sacredness of purity, of the sacredness and the covenant relationship that God wants in a marriage. Now you listen to me. We're living in a sin-cursed world. Nothing I hardly know about is ideal. Amen. You know, we're all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we're going to get to this a little bit. But the raw fact of it is a picture of the covenant relationship that you and your wife are to have. Let me tell you something. Think about this. You ever hear of the Old Testament and New Testament? It's Old Covenant and New Covenant. And that covenant was ratified by blood. And that and Jesus Christ is our sacrifice by blood, and it is a holy, holy thing. And it's talk, and by the way, is it not an eternal covenant? Yes, it is. And I'm saying this to you, that whenever you set those people, one of the things you're saying is, I mean when people are walking through the door and the ushers are saying, whose family are you with? And they set you over there, that is an establishment of a covenant, blood covenant setting. Covenant. Malachi said, you've dealt treacherously against the wife of thy covenant. Men, I want to give something here this morning. Let me tell you how you're going to have victory over roving eyes and secret lust for some woman besides your wife. Memorize Malachi chapter 2, where it says, thou hast dealt treacherously against the wife of thy youth. Now, I want you to get this. God said, you came through there in a covenant setting and made a covenant with Almighty God before those people. And I want you to understand that I do not take lightly when a husband deals treacherously against the wife of his youth. Now, why would the Holy Ghost put that in the Bible? Because men have a tendency as they get older to have wandering eyes and desires that are unholy. By the way, if you read that entire book, and Brother Jim probably preached the best message on it I ever heard, it has to do with betrayal. Nobody in this building wants to be betrayed. God will never betray you. But we betray him. But he tells us this, and men get this, because we're going to get into why men come in the building first. But God wants you to know something. You do not betray the wife of your youth. God will come in judgment. One of the reasons America is under judgment is because men have dealt treacherously with the wife of their youth all over this country. And it is a serious, serious matter. Now, weddings are wonderful. They should be full of joy and gladness. But let me tell you why they're not sometimes. It's because we've dealt treacherously. And we walk in and we put on the dog and show like everything's lovely, and it's not at all. And God wants you to know, first of all, so that you can have joy and gladness, God wants you to know that you're walking on holy ground. It is a covenant that's God sets up. And that's what a wedding is. So that's why the families are set on each side. Number two, what's the significance of a white runner? Why on earth? I tell you, the funniest thing in the world is watch two older brothers of the bride try to roll a piece of white cloth down the aisle. Isn't that the funniest thing you ever saw? I never saw one yet they didn't get hung up on. Or one got running in front of the other and got hung up, this, that, and the other. But why in the world did they put a white deal? God says it's holy ground. That's why it's called holy matrimony. It's a picture that you are standing on holy ground. This is not just going out here and doing a little business deal somewhere. This is not some other part of life. This is marriage. This is a wedding. This is a picture of Christ. This is a picture of salvation. This is a picture of the eternal state. Your Bible teaches. And God wants you to know something. This isn't something to be flippant. Let me tell you something. I ain't doing no weddings where they're playing Dolly Parton. I'm not doing no weddings where they're playing honky-tonk music. This is sacred ground, holy ground. And when that bride comes up through them, they put that forward. I'm telling you something. God is making a statement that you are walking on holy ground. This is not to be trifled with. It's a joyful occasion. It's a wonderful occasion. It's a beautiful thing. But don't you put a don't you secularize this thing. Don't you take it away from God. Don't you take it away from the meaning of it. Don't you take it away from its ultimate consummation in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why they have a white runner that comes down through the aisle there. Matthew chapter 19, so forth. It's God that puts them together. Do you ever notice when a preacher gets done, he said, "What God?" He didn't say, "What I joined together." What God? It's holy ground. God said, "Moses, take your shoes off." Why? You're on holy ground. Now, some of you girls, I expect you to come barefoot to your wedding. You go barefoot around here all the time. You can go barefoot your wedding day. You're supposed to laugh right there, amen? So I get so tickled these girls running around and they just have a beautiful dress on there, just barefoot as they can be. They're going to find out you're from the Ozarks if you ain't careful, girls. Amen. But I'm saying this to you, that's why they put that white runner down. Hey, boys, it's holy ground. Girls, it's holy ground. And God wants you to know that. God told Moses, put your shoes off. The place where thou standest is holy ground. Number three, why are parents of the couple given special seating? When they walk in there and they save them spots for their mom and daddy. They don't set them back over in the corner. They don't set them back in the back somewhere over outside. Mama and daddy and grandma and grandpa and those close relatives set up there close. Amen. Oh, I know why they set them up close so they can see them real good. No, that ain't it. No, it shows the position of authority and responsibility that those people have in their life. Listen to me this morning. Parents ought to be honored in your wedding ceremony. You ought to honor your mom and dad in your wedding ceremony. I believe that with all my heart. What a shame not to honor your parents in a wedding ceremony. You say, well, you don't know about my mom. You don't know about my dad. You can still honor them. I didn't say you had to like what they did or what went on in life, but you can still honor them as your father and your mother. But I'll say this to you. They enter in as a line of authority in their lives, and they leave out as a line of counsel. That's the deal. Now, I want to tell you something. The Bible tells a boy, you leave your father and your mother, and you be joined into your wife, right? Now, what's that about? That means that you don't tell your new wife that her cooking ain't as good as mama's. Don't you ever say that to her. She'll hit you with a frying pan, and you'll wake up 6 weeks later. You leave them, amen? You leave them. But that doesn't mean you don't honor them. And I'm saying this to you, that they're given special seating because they are at a place of honor. God never said to quit honoring your mother and your father. Watch Proverbs 23:22. Hearken unto thy father that begat thee, and despise not thy mother when she's old. There's never a time when you don't honor them and respect them and appreciate them and put them and keep them in place. You're going to need them one way or another. You may not think you do, but you're going to need them. You need their prayers. You need their love. You need their counsel. You need their wisdom. Ain't none of us so smart that we don't need that. The fourth thing is, why does the groom enter the auditorium first? Well, the groom comes in first because he's the initiator of the covenant. And he is to be the spiritual leader of that home. He's to take the initiative and the leadership, and he comes in first, and that's a statement being made that I have initiated. By the way, who initiated your salvation? Jesus Christ initiated your salvation. By the way, the cross is holy ground, amen. I'm saying to you, everything in here has a picture of biblical significance. So anyway, he comes in first. That's saying, I am willing to be the spiritual leader. I'm assuming responsibility. I'm assuming the authority that I should have as the husband in this marriage. He's the covenant initiator. Can I say to you, he has the greater responsibility to keep that marriage together. There are no excuses. Now, I'm the sorriest husband in this building, but I tell you, I do have the responsibility. It's my responsibility to lead our home in the ways of God. And it's every man, you boys, listen, it's your responsibility. When you come in, I'll tell you what, I won't be shocked if somebody tries to pop this one off. We're going to have her come in first because she's going to be the head of the house. Wow. That's the way they're living. That's the way you're living after you got married, you little wimps out there. You boys need to lead your home, amen. They're coming in first and saying, I'm going to be a man. I'm going to be a husband. I'm going to provide for her. I'm going to protect her. We're going to go to church. We're going to serve God. As sorry as I may be, but I'm going to lead in this thing. I'm going to be responsible as a husband. I'm going to be a man. I'm going to be a husband.
I'm going to keep this thing together. Well, there are about 40 different rabbit trails I'd like to chase, but I ain't going to because we got too many of these. Number five, why does the father walk the bride down the aisle? Now, I'm going to say something to you. If you look up Numbers, and you don't need to look it up right now, we'll get that a little bit later. But you'll find out, here's a biblical truth. A young lady, honestly, God never removes her from out under the authority of her father until he hands her off to the wife. There's never a time when a young lady is to be without a covering. Someone in her world that can protect her and provide for her and help her. And God's been dealing with me about this. God, listen, there's a reason that the father walks her down. It one of the things is he is saying, I endorse this young man to be your husband. I'm agreeing with this. I'm going with this. I approve of this. But another thing is he's presenting her to him. I have been her authority. I have been her provider. I've been her protector. And I'm presenting her to you. Do you know what Paul said to the Christian church over in 2 Corinthians 11:2? He said, I'm jealous over you with a godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Did you know that we're so far gone from the Bible in this country, nobody thinks anything about this stuff. They think it's corny. They think it's stupid. Old Testament law. They think all that stuff. But the truth about it was, this was so important in the Old Testament. I believe Deuteronomy chapter 22, I believe is where you find it. But the husband was to so take care of that daughter that he could present her to her husband as a virgin. And if that husband that she married to claimed afterward that she wasn't, they could bring the evidence out, and if it was a slander and false, they could fine that man. The elders of the city could fine him for putting a false accusation against the daughter of Israel. But if it was found, watch, listen, you better be glad you ain't in the law. It was found out that he had lied to the boy, and she had lied to the boy, and she was not a virgin, she could be stoned. Now, I'm going to throw something at you real quick right here. Hang on to your hat. This book right here that I'm preaching this morning, and this stuff's serious to me. This is bad serious to me because our country's shot because we've abandoned marriage principles of the Bible. And we just thought they're corny, they're out of date, don't mount anything. It's God's word, I'm telling you. But I want you to never forget this. Ever. This book, both Old Testament and New Testament, constantly teaches, commands, and affirms about purity in the area of morality, both before marriage and after marriage. But I'm going to give you one of the biggest ironies I know about in the Bible. When I say irony, it's like a contrasted, it's like totally the other side. Did you know that when Matthew chapter 1 records the genealogy of Jesus Christ, that it includes five women and only five women? Did you know that the first four women listed in the genealogy of Jesus Christ have pretty sordid backgrounds? Or at least came from sordid backgrounds? Rahab? What was she? Tamar, what was she? She was a daughter-in-law that had incest with father-in-law. I'm talking about sordid stuff. Ruth is listed in there. She came from the Moabite background, which was Lot's descendants. The only woman listed in there without a degraded background was Mary. Four is the number of world. Five is the number of grace. Why in the world did God not include some of the nice women who never did anything wrong? Why did he only put one in there? You know why? Because most of us are just wicked sinners. And we need grace. And five is the number of grace. What was God telling us? He's telling us that I give grace. I came to save sinners. I'm going to tell you one other thing about this irony about all the teaching of purity and morality in the Bible. When Jesus Christ was in his ministry, you tell me the kind of women that he was ministered to and with mostly. Harlots. Shack-ups. The woman at the well. She wasn't even married to the guy she was living with. The woman they brought to in John chapter 8. caught in adultery. Go and sin no more. What was Mary Magdalene? Cast out seven devils. If you'll study it out, most of the women, here's the purpose, here's the deal is, why am I saying this? Don't you ever forget that the gospel is for sinners. Amen. Not the, Jesus said, I came to seek and to save the lost and not the righteous. And unless, if you think you're so sweet and righteous that you don't need a Savior, you'll never be saved. If you don't realize, I'm going to balance this thing out. I'm going to hit both ways. I'm preaching as a pastor, and your folks and your granddaddy and your grandma, they ought to want you to live. Kids, they do not want you to get messed up in immorality. They want you to go into that wedding ceremony pure before God. Can I tell you something? Yes, God can forgive, but I'll tell you right now, those scars will get you. And you, I'm telling you, they'll get you. But here's what I want to tell you. If you don't and you are not, there's grace and there's forgiveness. And if we don't have that message, I'm going home right now. This is a church for sinners that need the grace of God and the forgiveness of God. Do we want to straighten up and do right? Yes. But I'm telling you, if you'll read your Bible right, the ones that God put in the genealogy of His Son Jesus Christ, four of them had bad backgrounds. Only one had a pure background. And when Jesus was on this earth, most of the women that ministered with and He ministered to were not sweetie pies that never did nothing wrong. Y'all got that? Because you better get that one. Because you're going to need it. And just so much I like to say, we're going to keep trucking here. I need to get... The next one is the real significance of the white dress. Why does a bride wear a white dress? I wish to own a bridal store, don't you guys? Man, I heard somebody here a while back spent $30,000 on a wedding. Man, I don't know. Man, that's out of my league. Amen. Did you know you can have a beautiful wedding and not spend a whole lot of money? You know what? I'd rather, if I was one of you girls, I'd say, Daddy, I don't want no $5,000 wedding. I want $5,000 cash. I'll take care of the wedding. No. Amen. I'm honest with you about that. But why? I want to get to something here this morning now. I want you to listen very carefully. And our time is going hard and fast, but we're going to get there. Now, why does a bride wear a white wedding dress? This white wedding dress, most everybody knows in this church house, symbolizes purity, not of body, but also of spirit and heart. Hey, girls, boys, listen to me. You can be physically pure, but mentally corrupt. All right? The white wedding dress represents purity. To be honest about it, just be rank honest about it, it is making a statement coming down the aisle to those that are there before God that I am pure before the Lord. That's right. And let's just be honest about it. If you wear a white dress and you're not, what? It's not honest. Now, I'm going to throw something at you. I think it is possible that a young lady could get saved or get right with God, get pure before... Is not the blood of Jesus Christ cleansed from all sin? Yeah, it does. So I believe if they came and said, you know something, no, I am not pure in the sense of that, but I've asked God's forgiveness, and the white dress I'm wearing is reflecting the righteousness of Christ, not my own. It's a real quiet in here, and I understand it. I'm having a hard time preaching this, but I dealt with this issue in my book, and I want to read to you something because I think it'll explain it better. Because this is a, let me just tell you something. This is a big issue, whether you believe it or not. No way to count the girls that have stood at the back of the church or wherever they get married coming forward, and Satan was tormenting them in their mind. You're wearing a white dress. You're not pure. You're wearing a white dress. You're not pure. You're wearing a white dress. You're not pure. Going on a honeymoon. You wore a white dress. You put on the dog. I'm telling you, you'll get set up for a nonstop satanic torment with this if you don't handle this biblically. That's why wedding ceremonies are important. They say, they mean things. In chapter 71, to get the background of the story, this girl, the girl in this book is named Carla. Her mother's name is Carlene. Carla, at the book, she's 17 years old. She's just getting ready to go into her senior year. And she meets a young man from California that's back here looking for a place that his ancestors had. And in the course of the summer, they get together, and she winds up before he goes back to California expectant. She was scared to tell her mother, and she took a bus to California, and they were supposed to get married, got out there, and everything turned around, and he got back with his old people and didn't want to marry her. She comes back to here to the Ozarks, and she's with child, and she's not married. A few weeks later, the boy that, the father of the child, he shoots himself out in California. This is in the story. He shoots himself. And now she is a 17-year-old girl carrying a baby, and the father of it's dead. As you go through the story in the book, there's the church that she went to. Her dad had been killed in Vietnam. She's out in the cemetery one day, and she is really going through it. I mean, she thought about killing herself, the whole gamut. She goes down to the cemetery to sit by her daddy's grave, and somebody drives up to the church. She doesn't know who it is. She doesn't recognize who it is, but they wind up visiting and come to find out it's the boy that came from Kentucky to fill in the pulpit of the church till they get a new pastor. They visit. Later on, he takes a liking to her. Now remember that she is with child, 17 years old, and he's filling in for pastor. He's a preacher, young preacher. And he sets his eyes on her and affection toward her. At a pie supper, he literally buys her pie, and while eating it, tells her that if the Lord will work it out, he wants to marry her. She tries to tell him, "You can't do that. You're a preacher. I am an unwed mother with a child out of wedlock. And the father of the child is dead." He then tells her that he had been married, and when his wife was carrying the first child, had a wreck, and were both killed. Long story short, she asked me to marry her, gets approval for it, and they're going to get married. They're getting really close to the wedding date, and he's at work. He's a log cutter out in the woods, and getting close to the door today. She's getting bugged bad. And I want you to get this. She's getting bothered bad, and she drives down to his workplace about the time that he gets off work. And I must pick up the story, and I'll try to be brief. The last few days leading up to the wedding were a blur for Carla. The wedding was having some sobering effects upon her, even in the midst of her joy and anticipation. She and Carly and her mother had discussed the wedding and plans for it. Carla wanted it simple and held at her church. It was at the church where she had learned about God, the church where she worshiped each Sunday, and she knew that even though the church was people, not a building, their gathering there at that location was a public statement, a testimony to the community of their personal faith and commitment to the Lord. Even more, Carla knew that the church and Jesus were a mysterious picture of marriage between a man and a woman, and that it was, after all, God who designed, created, and ordained marriage, and she wanted to be and would be married in her church. Carlene had never brought it up, and Carla knew she wouldn't. Her wedding dress would not be white. She did not want it to be white. An interesting thing that, I want you to listen carefully now, an interesting thing that Carla had observed was how various reactions of people were to her sin of fornication. Their reactions ran from pharisaical contempt and almost ready to stone her, to others who were so merciful, they acted as if she had done absolutely nothing wrong, and they were ready to stone anyone who believed she had sinned. Carla knew that neither side was right. She had come to the conclusion that other folks' feelings and reactions and ideas and conclusions did not matter. For her to have genuine peace, to be able to go on and get beyond her sin, she had to respond biblically, not emotionally or socially. She could not stone herself, but neither could she wash her hands and wipe her mouth and say, "I have done nothing wrong." She did not want to become hard and calloused in comparing herself to others or tip the scales in an attempt to say that her sin was not any worse than anybody else's. She knew that a biblical response was the only way for her to go. Humility, honesty, godly sorrow and repentance, coupled with a forsaking of sin, was what's needed. Turning from her sin with a dependence upon the merits and the priceless value of the blood of Jesus Christ to take away her sin was the only route she could take. But the toughest part for her was the reaping. The reaping for Carla seemed at every turn in the road now. It often would cause even her to wonder if she was truly saved and forgiven. Carla had finally come to understand that reaping, listen now, reaping was the universal law of God in life and was distinct and separate from the fact of God's judicial mercy and forgiveness. David in the Bible was forgiven, but he still reaped. This meeting with Lincoln, this was the guy she was going to marry, this young preacher she was going to marry. This meeting with him was a reaping in Carla's eyes. Had she not sinned, she would not have needed to have this talk with him. The thought came to Carla that had she not gotten involved with Greg, who is the boy that was the father of the child who had shot himself, if she had not met him and gotten involved with him, would she have eventually met and married Lincoln? If she had just waited and done right, she could be coming down the aisle to Lincoln, not just in a white dress, but unknown by any other man. 1,000 possible trails went off into the thicket of what ifs in her mind. But what ifs didn't count now. They were a waste of her time. Things were at the what is stage, not the what if. So she had driven to Lincoln's job site, bringing him something to eat. Lincoln and the men were shutting down for the day, refilling and preparing to be ready for tomorrow. Lincoln's little LUV pickup had become a symbol for Carla. She enjoyed playing the game with the letters and so forth, and I'm going to skip a little bit there. As he approached her vehicle, she said to herself, "Man, he's good looking," she thought to herself, but she couldn't hide her heart from him. As he approached her, he said, "What's wrong, beautiful?" "Oh, not much," she said, "just need to discuss something with you." "You haven't backed out on me, have you?" "No, but I want to give you that freedom." Lincoln flashed a shade of anger. "What's up? What's the matter?" She began, "I guess, Lincoln, I'm reaping in my mind and in my heart." Lincoln said, "Get it out. Tell me. Talk to me now." A large, single, lonely tear coursed down her cheek as she looked down. And she continued, "Lincoln, Mom and I discussed the wedding. Not about you and I getting married, but you know, things like decorations, cakes, invites, the ceremony and all that." And then Lincoln interjected, "Carla, listen, there's only one thing I care about and all that, and that's the bride, you. I don't care how you do it or don't decorate or who you invite or any of that stuff. I don't worry about it. Just do what you want and enjoy it. I'll be happy." And then she said, "Lincoln, do you care, do you mind that I will not be wearing a white dress?" He looked at her and shook his head and he said, "Is that what this is all about?" "That was settled a long time ago for me, Carla. I respect whatever you decide." She said, "Lincoln, the other day while Mom and I were discussing our wedding plans, Mom stayed away from the subject of a dress, and I knew why, and I knew she would. But it brought out to me more vividly the issue of it. Lincoln, if you want out of this marriage, I won't blame you. The fact of thinking about walking down the aisle to you, knowing that I'm not a virgin, that I've been with another man, that I'm carrying the child of another man, then thinking about you, watching me come towards you in a dress that symbolizes that fact, well, I'm really struggling today about it. And I don't ever want you to be tormented, maybe lying in bed some night and the image of the thought of me being with another man tearing you up. I couldn't stand it. I'm so sorry that I cannot come to you untainted with my past." Lincoln reached his arm around Carla and pulled her to his shoulder and chest as tears were trickling down her cheeks. The smell of sawdust mingled with fuel came out of his jacket. And he just held her for a while. Then quietly and slowly he said, "Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." And then he continued, "Where are thine accusers? The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses from all sin. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth." Her tears flowed freely onto his jacket, and she thought to herself, what was the worth of a man who would or even could say such things to her? Then she heard him say, "I will remember their sin no more." He said, "Carla, when I came to Christ, I came in my sin, not in my purity or sinlessness. I came as a guilty sinner that I was. God forgave me, washed me, cleansed me, and justified me. And you and I are going to have to take each other the same way for this to work." And I'd say for anybody and everybody here, that's how you got to get married. You got to take that person like Christ takes you. He continued to say, "After today, I don't ever want to hear any more about this. Is it not true that you could say the same about me?" Carla said, "It's not the same. Your wife died." But he said, "Yes, it is the same. Do you think I was pure as the driven snow apart from Christ? Will you be tormented thinking about me? I hope not. We can't change those things. Another thing, Jesus said, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Where does that put me at?" "I don't know," she said. "Weren't you honest with me when we met?" "Yes," she said. "Didn't I fall in love with you anyway?" "Yeah, I guess," she answered. "I don't think I fell in love. It was deliberate. But didn't I openly pursue you and court you?" "Well, that's for sure. Don't you think I put some thought in all these things?" "Well, I would hope that you would." "Okay, then. I accept you as you are. I love you as you are. And I sure haven't chased you this far to let you go this close to the wedding. It's too late, Carla. I'm going to marry you if I have to drag you down the aisle myself. You got me for the rest of your life, so you just will get used to it. I don't want no more of this ever, okay?" I was preparing this message. I've dealt with a lot of junk in 42 years of preaching. I've dealt with my own junk. And what I want to get across today is that it's God's will for you to stay pure morally. And you'll be way better off if you do. But if something happens and you don't, I don't want you to ever forget that Jesus died for sinners. Jesus was asked the question of whom loved much. He said, of whom much was forgiven. That's the sixth out of 20 or 21. It's 12:12. And I'm going to quit. I want the pianist to come. I'll finish this tonight after the demonstration we have. I want us to bow our heads for prayer. I want you to please listen to me. Not that I deserve you to listen to me, but I want you to listen for your own sake. Marriage is a picture of Christ in the church. Truth be known, Jesus said to you one day, "Will you marry me?" Didn't he? If you're saved, what happened was you told him yes. Did you know that he went away to prepare a place for us? Did you know we're coming back with him after that wedding in heaven? We're going to have a 1,000-year honeymoon. But here's my message to you today. And this didn't go nothing like I wanted it to go or thought it was going to go, but I can't help that. God wants you to be saved. If you're here today and you're not saved, he's asking you. Can you imagine? The creator of this world wants you to be part of the bride of Christ. He wants you to say, I will, to Jesus. Now, if you're not saved, right there where you're sitting right now, I'd encourage you just to bow your heart before God and say, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And I believe on the death, burial, and resurrection of your son, Jesus Christ. I could take you through all the wedding traditions and ceremonies, even to the fact of paying the dowry, that Jesus paid the dowry, his own blood. He bought, purchased us with his own blood. Preparing the place, coming back. It's all in the Bible. But here's where I want to go with this right now. My heart, again, goes out to you young people. And I want to talk to the boys right now. We've got a little bit here. Boys, I want to ask you something. If you're of age to be thinking about these things, I'm going to ask you, as the piano starts playing, and you'd like to make a commitment to God that by his grace you'd keep yourself pure to marriage. God, I need your help. Now, can I just tell you, without his help, you can do nothing. You say, well, I never get myself in that situation. You don't know what happened. You say, Lord, I want to stay. And I want to do it not just for your sake, God, but for my future wife's sake. I'm asking you to come. Can I tell you, the spiritual level of this young group of young people will be the very degree of the boys in this church, the young men of this church. And all I'm asking you to do is just say, Lord, I can't on my own. But dear God in heaven, if you'll give me grace, I'd like to be able to kiss my bride with a pure heart and pure life. Would you come? You just do as the Lord would lead you today. God bless you. A lot of boys. Boy, I appreciate these men. Jason, I'd like you, if you can, I'd like you to come up here in just a second, if you won't care. I'm going to give you just a little bit more to come. You want to come? Just make a commitment to the Lord. You say, Reggie, but what if I don't keep my commitments? You know something? I'd rather ask God's help than not help. That's what I'd rather do. I'd rather ask God for help. As far as I can tell you, I can tell you right now, you're going to need help from God. You're going to need help from God. There ain't no crime asking God for help. Best thing I can do for the girls of this church is encourage you boys to rise to the occasion, to be men of character. Now, girls, I'm going to ask you, find a place. If you say, you know what, I'm going to ask God, Lord, I'd like to, by your grace, if God allows me to be married, I'd like to come to my wedding. God, keep me. God, keep me. Would you come? No song and dance, nothing like that. But you just say, God, I'd like you to keep me. I want you to come right now. God bless you, young lady. Lord, I'd like you to keep me. We are kept by the power of God. Just a time of commitment to the Lord. Amen. 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 It's some of the most serious stuff you're ever going to deal with in your life. You're living in a time unlike Amen. That's good. Somebody else, you want to come? Sister Terry, I'm going to ask you to take Sister Desiree's babies. And Sister Desiree, I'd like for you to come up here if you don't care, please. Would that be okay? Is that okay, Brother Jason? You're a young lady and you'd just like to come and say, Lord, help us. I'm going to ask Jason right now to pray. And whether you went back to your seat or not, or still here, I'm asking Jason. I'm going to ask you to come pray for these boys. And then I want Desiree, I want you to pray for these girls if you'll come and pray for them. Please pray for these young people. There's nothing Satan likes to do more than train wreck the youth of this church.
Our gracious Father in heaven, we want to praise you that you are God.
Yes.
And that you never change. Thank you, Father, that you're faithful. I thank you for your mercy that you pour out upon us each and every day.
Yes.
I thank you for the kindness that you showed us upon the cross. I thank you, Father, for giving us your word so we can know the truth and that the truth to make us free. I thank you, Father, for spelling it out in your word what's right and what's wrong. And Father, we live in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. But thank you that you're faithful. And we want to pray for these young men and for these young ladies. We pray for our children. Lord, for your power and your protection for them. I pray that you give these young men a love for you, Lord, that'll go beyond their lust, their sinful desires. Lord, the desires that are good that will also can lead them astray. And I pray that their love for you will go beyond it all. And I pray for the power and the presence of your Spirit upon their life. And Lord, as they live life, and Lord, they end up in places they shouldn't be, and they see things they shouldn't see. And Father, I pray for the power of your Spirit to be upon them and that you would protect them and keep them. Thank you, Lord, for how you kept me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the strength to say no when I needed to. And thank you, Father, for the times when I didn't have the power to say no, that you kept me from sin. By your grace, I praise you. I thank you. And thank you, Father, for the times when I did fall, that you had the grace and the mercy to pick me back up. And I pray, Father, you'd do that same work in the lives of these young men. Father, draw them to you. I pray you give them a love for you, a supreme love above all the other things, that they would love you and love your word. And I pray you protect them and help them and carry them through. And I pray, Father, you'd help them to be submitted to the Spirit of God and yielded to you. And pray you'd lead them through as only you can. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today. Lord, we lift up all these young people that have come here to make a decision, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would work in each of their hearts. Lord, I lift up all of these young ladies to you. Lord, you can see each of their hearts where we can't. Lord, you know their desires. Lord, you know every thought that they have. Lord, I pray first and foremost that you would show them that they are enough. They are made in your image, and you love them just as they are. Lord, I pray that you would help us older women to help to teach them, Lord, the right way to go, and Lord, that they would put you first in their lives, and that no man can totally complete them, Lord, but you can. And Lord, I pray that you would give them just a satisfaction of knowing that they are your daughters, Lord. And God, I pray that you would bless their faithfulness and bless their willingness to follow and serve you. Lord, I pray that you would bring them godly spouses, Lord, but first and foremost that they would put you first in their lives. Lord, because we know that with you, you can make all things good. And we just thank you for what you've done in our lives. Lord, thank you for the blessing that my marriage has been, Lord. And It only comes from putting you first. Lord, I pray that you would help us all to be godly spouses and be a testimony to the young people in this church. Lord, may they serve you with their whole hearts. We just want to tell you we love you and praise you. In your name we pray. Amen.
I want the pianist to continue to pray, to play. I like every head bowed, every eye closed. I know that now tonight, hopefully maybe we'll finish this. But as our heads are bowed and eyes closed, I want to really, really encourage people here that if there's sin in your past, I want you to know that God forgives and His blood cleanses from all sin. You've got to know that. You have got to believe that. And I want to encourage you right where you're at right now this morning. Say, Lord, if you've never confessed your sin to Him, that's what you must do. If you're saved, you must confess to Him. You must confess to Him your sin. But would you accept His forgiveness? That He shed His blood for you? I'm telling you, please do not carry this. Put it behind you. He'll remember it against you no more. Ask Him, Lord, forgive me. Don't justify it. Don't blame somebody. Don't rationalize it. Confess it. And He said, if you confess your sins, He'd be just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Please do that today. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, I know this is a tender subject, but it's a needful subject. It's very much in the Bible, very much in the Bible. I encourage you to do that. Let's stand together. People are still praying, but we're going to just dismiss you and hope to see you tonight. And we'll be down in the auditorium, bring a chair with you. And I don't know what to say. You're dismissed. I love you in the Lord. Thanks for putting up with me. It's hot, ain't it? Sleepy. Be all right.